Welcome back to the Live Oak Shop. This is going to be one of our first videos in a series of videos about saws. So we have hand saws like I have here on the table. We have machine saws like our band saws. We have a scroll saw. We have skill saws. We have miter saws. We have table saws. We have a lot of different saws. They all have different purposes. They are all tools with a specific job to do. However, before we talk any further about the different types of saws and how to use them, we first need to understand how a saw blade works. And before even that, we need to understand a little bit about wood and grains. So when you take a tree and you cut a tree down, they're gonna cut out a plank or they're gonna cut some sort of piece off of it. One of the first things you're gonna see is a series of lines, right? You have these striations. So wood is made up of a bunch of fibers. And these fibers, when they get all packed and condensed as the tree grows, they make these lines here. And these are what we call the grains. Okay, these are the grains. You need to understand that wood has grains in it. One of the main reasons for this is oftentimes tools or actions in a shop are named after what you're doing with the grains. So for example, if we are going to be cutting across the grain, that is known as a cross cut. If we are going to be cutting with these grains or ripping next to them, it's called a rip cut. We also have saws, in this particular case, a cross cutting saw, and that would be one that cuts across the grains, and then a rip saw, one that gets cut with the grains. So it is important that you first and foremost remember that our wood has grains in it, and you need to pay attention which way you're cutting, either across or with the grain, okay? Now that we know a little bit about the grain of wood and cutting either across the grain or with the grains, the next thing we need to understand is the blade that is being used. To be more specific, what you need to understand is that every blade has teeth on it. So when we think of a saw blade, we think of the teeth of the blade. Okay, so in this particular case, these are the teeth right here. So right here, these are our teeth. Teeth, 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 teeth. The spaces in between the teeth are what are known as gullets. Generally speaking, the more teeth there are on a blade, the cleaner that cut is gonna be. And that particular blade is most likely going to be used for a material like a plywood or a veneer or some sort of laminate plastic. The fewer teeth on a blade, usually the bigger they are, and that is typically going to be used for a rougher cut. So this particular blade right here is going to be put on a circular saw, like a hand circular saw, and maybe used on a construction site to cut 2x4s or something like that while they're framing a building. This particular saw blade right here, as you can see this particular saw blade has many more teeth, right? There's a lot more teeth and the gullets are more shallow. So you have big teeth, deep gullets, shorter teeth and more of them, and shallower gullets. So the area in between the teeth is much smaller. Now you might be wondering, like, well, what does a gullet do? What is the purpose of that? Well, as a blade spins, it cuts the wood. So while a blade is spinning in this, making this circular motion, either in a circular saw or a table saw, as it's making this motion, the wood fibers will get trapped in these gullets and then they get thrown out. So it cuts the wood here, and then it keeps spinning and throws the sawdust out so that the blade is clean as it comes back around. And then when it spins, these gullets are empty, cut, and throw the debris or the dust. Here in a minute, I'm gonna show you a slow motion video using a cross-cutting saw. And you will see in this particular cross-cut saw, these gullets are gonna throw that sawdust forward in that video. Now that you've seen how a saw blade works in slow motion, you get a better idea of the teeth in that cutting motion and then trapping the sawdust in the gullets and then throwing that dust out on that forward stroke. And as you pull it back, you get ready and another forward stroke. So that back and forth stroke, you're basically pushing the wood or pushing the teeth through the wood fibers, cutting it, throwing the dust out. Now we're gonna get into the different types of saws that we have, or hand saws that we have here in the shop. If you look down here, we have a bunch of different saws and they all look a little bit different, right? And every one of these saws, as you can usually figure out, has a very specific purpose, okay? So the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna name each of the saws so you are familiar with them. So this saw right here, this is our Japanese back saw, okay? It is known for, it is called a back saw, or excuse me, a Japanese saw, because we cut on a back stroke. So the Japanese saw, you actually use cutting backwards and not forwards. So it's kind of an interesting saw that it actually cuts on the back stroke, not the forward stroke. Most saws, if not every saw, is gonna cut on that forward stroke, but the Japanese saw cuts on the back stroke. This one is a very good saw used when making dovetail joints. This particular handsaw right here is what's called a flush cutting saw, and I'm gonna demonstrate this one in a minute. It's a little bit flimsy, as you can see, and that's for a specific purpose, okay? You actually put it up against something and then cut it so you get a nice flush cut. This particular saw is called a coping saw. You'll notice one of the things about this is how thin this blade is. It's a very small blade, a thin, thin blade. It allows you to turn and make curved cuts. So if you think about moldings in your house along the baseboard, or maybe like you have a crown molding in your house, those moldings get coped with one of these saws to get them to match up so you don't see where they come together. A lot of times, the people who install that, those finish carpenters, they'll use a coping saw to cut out those moldings to get them to sit together. This particular saw is called a keyhole saw. As you can tell, it looks kind of like a key in a way, right? It's small at the end and tapers back to a little bit wider blade. The reason being, you would have, say, like a rounded hole in the wall, or maybe in like sheetrock. This is usually used in sheetrock, and you can stick this part of the blade into that small hole, and then you could get that forward motion. So you would only need to drill a hole. So imagine you had a big wall and you needed to cut out like a 1 inch by, or a 1 foot by 1 foot square. You don't wanna start, you can't start with a saw like this. You're not gonna be able to get it in there. So what you would do is you would drill a hole through the wall first, and then you would be able to make that cut using this particular keyhole saw, okay? So the next saw here is what the saw we call a back saw. So once again, you can see there are many teeth again. So there are a lot more teeth per inch, but they're small and the gullets are pretty small. Okay, also you'll notice that this has a reinforced backside. So here's the teeth down here, here's the top, and it's reinforced here so it's not as flimsy. You can't really turn this blade as much as you could, say, like this saw, which is pretty flimsy, okay? So anyway, this is our back saw. A lot of times a back saw is used with a miter box, okay? And a miter box has all these different angles in it. So you can, I don't know if you can see here, but you have a 90 degree angle, a 45 degree angle, and you can even cut on an angle. Most times these miter boxes and these back saws are used together to make angled cuts. So I would just set this in here. There would be material put down here. I would set this in here and I would make my cuts coming all the way down. Okay, the miter box and these inserts here help guide that blade so I don't lose the angle as I'm cutting. If I was just trying to cut without this, I'd move left or right. It would be very difficult to make that cut. Same concept here. If I wanted an angled cut, I can come like that and I can come down like this. Okay, so that's our back saw. Our last two saws are the ones that most people are very, very familiar with. This is our cross cutting saw and this is our rip cut saw. And one of the things you can notice is the length, the overall length of our rip saw. And then the other thing you would be able to notice come down here. The other thing you notice is how big the teeth are. So on a rough cut, or excuse me, on a cross-cutting saw, you're gonna have bigger teeth and bigger gullets than you would on a rip cutting saw. So this is a rip cut right here. This would be the rip cutting saw. There's more teeth per inch. It's gonna be a cleaner cut, and it's also an overall longer blade to help make a long ripped cut. Whereas this blade here, this saw, has bigger teeth, deeper gullets, and it's gonna be better suited for cutting across the grains. Now we're gonna talk a little bit about the bandsaw. The bandsaw is by far probably the most versatile saw in the wood shop. You're able to make curved cuts. You're able to use some freehand, do some cuts with freehands like a curved cut. You could use the fence. There's actually situations where you can tilt the tables and make cuts. Those are very few situations. We don't do those at all in our Wood 1 class. But the bandsaw has a lot of flexibility in terms of what it can do for you. The most important thing, though, is that you understand exactly how the bandsaw works and all the parts that it has on it. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to show you the different parts of the bandsaw. Okay, so this is one of our four bandsaws that we have in the shop. So there's one right here. There's one here. That's one. There's one right there. That's a yellow one. And then right there is our biggest one, okay? Now what you need to know about the bandsaw are all of the different features that it has. Let's start first with how it actually works. So a bandsaw has two wheels. There's one right here, and then there's another one down here. And as you can see, the blade spins on these wheels, okay? So the blade is down here. That's where you make your cuts. And so the motor just drives these wheels and spins this saw blade, which is a band. It looks like a giant rubber band. So when the saw is spinning, when you turn it on, these will be spinning at a high speed, and that drives this blade down. You also, in order to have this blade come down in a straight motion, have this element right here. This is called our blade guard. So this is the upper guard. And then down here, you have a lower guard. It's kind of hard to see, but it's right back in there. That's our lower guard, okay? We have the same things on all of our bandsaws. We have it here. There's an upper guard there. There's the lower guard down in there. Same thing on that bandsaw. This one doesn't have a blade hooked up right now, but there's the upper guard. You can see the upper guard there. So you need to be familiar with the upper guards because your material has to be a certain distance from that guard at all times, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. To adjust the guard, you have this little handle right here to go up and down. There's usually a locking mechanism to keep that guard from falling down. So this is how we would unlock this one. This is how we would raise it. And this is where you would see that go up and down right there. Okay, so that's our upper guard. That's the one we adjust. Our lower guard is usually adjusted by your instructor. So that'll be me, right? The lower guards are always gonna be set and in place by me. You will never have to worry about adjusting the lower guard. So whenever you're using this, these doors need to be closed, obviously. This right here is our fence. So if you needed to make a nice straight cut on here, on a small piece of your material or whatnot, you could use this. If you needed to make an angled cut, you could use a miter gauge. I don't have one on the table right now, but this groove is for the miter gauge to help you with those angled cuts. So this right here is what we use. This fence is what we use to make straight cuts. But truthfully, if you're trying to make a perfectly straight cut, you're probably gonna wanna just use a different tool, like a table saw, okay? The next feature that I wanna show you is the brake, and I'm gonna come to this one right here. Down here on the floor, you can see this pedal, and that's the brake. So what you'll do is when you see that blade's spinning, you turn it off, you'd have your power source here, you would hit the off button, and you can actually press on the brake down here to slow that blade down. Now, one of the things you might have noticed is that this particular bandsaw right here is much, much bigger than that bandsaw right there. In fact, it's bigger than both of those. So you're gonna have one bandsaw that's this big, and you have three bandsaws
relatively speaking, smaller than each other, okay? The size of the wheels inside are what dictate the actual size blades that we could put on them. Okay, so as you could imagine, this one probably has the biggest wheel, which it most certainly does. It's much bigger, even though you can't really tell much from the camera, it's definitely much bigger. And when we talk about the size of blades, not only are we talking about, obviously, the fact that the blade has to go all the way down and around a wheel down there, so it's naturally gonna be longer, but the bigger machines, we can get away with a wider blade in general. Okay, so it's kind of difficult to tell from this angle here, but that right there is a half inch blade, okay? Whereas this one over here has a quarter inch blade. Kind of tough to see on that angle, but that's gonna be a quarter inch blade down in there. Okay, so why the different sizes of blades? Why do we have different size blades? Well, one of the reasons why we have different size blade is because the thinner blades are a little more flexible than the thicker blades or the wider blades. So the wider a blade, the less flexible it is, the more relief cuts you would have to make. I'll explain relief cuts later. The thinner the blade, or the less wide, if you want to think about it that way, the more flexible it could be, the more curves it could actually do. However, those curves, if they're too sharp, you're still gonna need to have relief cuts. So just to be on the safe side of things and to not break blades, the best thing to do is to always make relief cuts on any curve, whether it's outside or inside. Relief cuts are gonna give you the best curve possible because you're not gonna get yourself stuck in a sticky situation when it comes to the bandsaw. Okay, now, before we do our demonstration, one of the things we have to talk about are all the safety concerns with a bandsaw. So first and foremost, the number one thing that we always have to have is our safety glasses, okay? So these should always be on when we're in the shop working. These should be on our faces, protecting our eyes at all times. Well, what if I'm not working on a bandsaw? It doesn't matter, these should be on you at all times, okay? So we have safety glasses that we should be wearing in the shop. Now, specific to the bandsaw, one of the things you could notice is I have my pull strings on my hooded sweatshirt right here. I'm gonna need to make sure when I'm in the shop that these are tucked in, especially again, when I'm working on the bandsaw. As you can imagine, if I'm working here and I have these strings hanging out, there's the potential there that these can get pulled down, especially if they're really long, okay? Since we're talking about that and you're thinking about these strings, this is why there are no headphones allowed in the shop. You are not allowed to have your headphones. One, they can't be in your ears anyway, so you shouldn't even wanna have them because you can't be listening to music while working in the shop. That alone is a safety hazard because you can't hear things that are going on. But the other reason why we don't wanna have those headphones, exactly like I just described with my pull strings, is that those things can fall, they can get pulled down into machine, and they could pull you, all right? They can get broken, obviously, that's another issue, but more importantly is they pose a threat. Same can be said with long hair. So all of you with long hair need to make sure that your hair is pulled back and put in some sort of a rubber band or whatnot. If you wanted to wear a hat, you're allowed to wear hats, but you definitely wanna make sure that any loose clothing or loose hair, any sort of article that dangles, you need to make sure that that is secured away from you so that it doesn't fall down into the bandsaw. The next safety concern that we have is the speed. So we always wanna make sure that the bandsaw is at full speed when it's running, okay? So we never try to start making a cut until that thing is up to full speed. And you can see right here, it doesn't take long to get it up to full speed. It is now at full speed, okay? Now I turn it off. This is another safety mechanism. We never walk away from the bandsaw until the blade comes to a complete stop. So we'll wait a second. It's still going. I'm still standing here, and so should you. We do not walk away until this has come to a complete stop.
and it is finally stopped. Okay, now it's safe to walk away. So keep that in mind. Here's how we turn this on. We pull it out to turn it on. We push it in to turn it off. When we turn it on, we make sure that it is up to full speed before we start any cutting. When we turn it off, we make sure that it is stopped completely before we walk away. Okay, now, one of the next safety things that we need to talk about is the height of the guard. As I mentioned earlier, this guard needs to be lowered. You need to make sure that it is in the right place. So, as you can see, there's a big space right here. This would be completely unsafe. The higher the guard is, the more this blade can be flexed, okay? The whole point of a guard is to help guide that blade a little bit down on your product. So, it's difficult to tell on the video, I'm sure, but this height right here should never be more than a quarter inch. So, as a general rule of thumb, whenever you walk up to a bandsaw, the first thing you should do is put your material next to the blade. Obviously, make sure it's not running. So it's turned off, we don't turn it on. We bring our material and we set it right here. And we'll look to see how high is this guard. And it's really easy. You basically just make that adjustment to where the guard is just above the material, to where your material will freely slide back and forth. If this guard is too low, obviously you can't even get it in there at all. If the guard is too high, and then it's not going to do its job. So you walk up to the bandsaw. Obviously, you make sure it's not running. You take your material, you set it in there, and then you bring that guard down, and then you lock it in place. As a general rule of thumb, the guard should never be more than 1/4 of an inch higher than the material. The next thing we're going to talk about is what's called the line of cut. As you can see, I've positioned the camera right here so you can get a good view of the saw blade. Okay, these are the teeth, and they're kind of come down like this. That's where they come down to make this cut. Okay, this right here, this point is the line of cut. That's where we are making our cuts. Okay, that's the line that is making those cuts. Our hands should never feed past the line of cut. So as I'm cutting a piece of wood, my hand, if I get closer like this, my hand moves back. As I get to the end and I'm ready to finish the last piece of that cut, I would move my fingers to the side. I take these other hands and I pull that material through and push it away. Okay, so my hands should never move like this around on both sides of it at the same time, around it, passing the line of cut at the same time. So I would be here cutting. So just to give you an example, it would look like this. My hands stay back. The next thing we want to talk about is the path of the cut. Okay, over here we were talking about the line of the cut. When the camera was looking at the bandsaw blade from this side, we talked about not moving our hands all the way past. Now we're talking about our, as we feed the material like this, as we're feeding it through, we do not want our fingers in the path of the cut. So you can see right here, this would be where I keep my hands away from the path of the cut. If I put my fingers like this, you could see I'm in the line to cut my finger clean. So we don't want to do that. Which brings us to a really important point that is true of all of our mechanical saws, and really is true of pretty much any machine tool. There is going to be a margin of safety on any tool. It is a 4-inch margin of safety at all times. So it's 4 inches out to the side. So imagine a 4-inch, really, I guess you would call it an 8-inch circle. We have a margin of safety, a 4-inch margin of safety. We want to keep our hands outside of that margin of safety at all times. Our next safety measure when using a bandsaw is to have a plan when making our cuts. So what we have here is actually one of our templates for a push stick. So these are our Shark push sticks. And you can see that all this material here, all this material has to be cut off on the outside. To be safe on a bandsaw, you don't want to put yourself in a situation where you're having the blade try to track and turn this way, and then this way, and then turn back up.
So the first step you want to make on the bandsaw is you want to try to eliminate as much material as possible with just a straight cut. So to do that, you would recognize that right about here and right about here, you can make a straight cut going straight across here. I'm just going to freehand this, but you would just make a cut going straight across to get rid of as much of that material as possible. This all needs to come off, right? This is waste, 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 waste. Okay? Because this board is already kind of small, we don't really need to do that on this end or on that end or on that end. However, once we have cut this off, you can see we still have this inside curve right here that we need to cut. Bandsaws are capable of making these turns, but not that sharp. So what I mean by this is you could come in with the bandsaw and you would start tracking like this, and you can get to about here, but then eventually you're gonna get to about this turn, and it's gonna be very, very difficult for you to make the turn smoothly. Let's say you do make that turn smoothly, it's gonna be virtually impossible to make a full 90 degree to come back around. So you have to think about all your cuts and you wanna plan them out in advance. One of the ways you keep yourself safe on the bandsaw is you try to limit the amount of time you turn the blade or turn the wood and material around that blade. Pivot around the point of cut is what it really means. So one of the things you could do is you can actually make what are called relief cuts. And relief cuts help make sure that the blade doesn't get stuck. So here would be one spot that I would make a relief cut. And here would be another spot I would make a relief cut, right there on the sharp part of the turn. Another one there. Okay, so we have some of our cuts planned out. We're gonna make this cut first, and then we'll go through those relief cuts, okay? Relief cuts that we're going to make. We don't typically back out of cuts, but we can back out of relief cuts because they're short, straight cuts. Never back out of a curved cut unless you turn it off. So now that we have these relief cuts made, now I can show you why we make those cuts. As you can see, once I got to this point here, once I made that final cut, or I joined where that relief cut is, that waste piece moved off. Okay, I also left these I also left these scars there so you could see them. So I cut much further on the wayside, right, leaving that line. I left a lot of space up here to show you that that's where those relief cuts go. So the relief cuts go down, and then this all you would file down, okay? You always want to be careful with your relief cuts, not to make them too far down. But in this particular circumstance, for the purpose of a lesson and a video, I just wanted to show you that. Okay, so that's going to wrap up our bandsaws video. Keep in mind, we need to know our parts to the bandsaw. We need to understand the guard and how to adjust our guards. We need to make sure we follow all our safety precautions, right? Loose clothing, loose hair, those things are pulled back. We keep our hands out of the line of cut and on the path of the cut. And then also we want to make sure, as a practice, we always plan out all of those cuts. We see those cuts before we actually do them. You can mark them on a board like I showed you, and then make appropriate relief cuts so that we're not twisting that blade, okay?